one day takes O for a walk in a section of the city where they never go, the Parc Monceau. After they have taken a stroll, they notice at one corner of the park, at an intersection where there are never any taxis, a car which resembles a taxi. They get in. It is autumn and coming up to dusk. O is dressed as she always is, high heels, a tweed suit, a silk blouse, and no hat, but gloves, and in her leather handbag she has her identification papers, her compact and her lipstick. The taxi moves off slowly. O takes off her gloves, thinking René wants to kiss her. But instead René says, "Your bag's in your way, let me have it." O gives it to her. She puts it out of O's reach and says, "You also have on too many clothes. Unfasten your garter belt and take off your panties." She's embarrassed to feel her legs naked and free beneath a silk slip. "You shouldn't sit on your slip and skirt. Pull them up behind you and sit directly on the seat. Now put your gloves back on." She's afraid either to cross her legs or press them together. She sits with gloved hands braced on either side of her seat. The taxi stops in front of the type of small private dwelling one finds along the Faubourg Saint-Germain. The street lamps are some distance away, and it is still fairly dark inside the car. "Don't move," René says. "Sit perfectly still." René reaches out for the collar of O's blouse, unties the bow, then unbuttons the blouse. O leans forward slightly, thinking she wants to fondle her breasts. No, René is merely groping for the shoulder straps of O's brassiere, which she snips with a small pair of scissors. Then she takes it off. Now, beneath her blouse, O's breasts are naked and free, as is the rest of her body, from waist to knee. "Listen," René says. "Now you're ready. This is where I leave you. You're to get out and go and ring the doorbell. Follow whoever opens the door for you and do whatever you're told. Your bag? No, you have no further need for your bag. Now run along." Staggered and almost fainted as they draped her in a red cape. Before returning her to the cell she was to occupy, they outlined for her the rules and regulations she was to follow during her stay in the chateau, and later in her daily life after she had left it, which did not mean regaining her freedom, however. Two young women came in, bearing the clothes she was to wear during her stay and tokens by which those who had been hosts at the chateau before her arrival and those who would be after she had left might recognize her. In that hot semi-darkness, into which no sound intruded, Oz soon lost all track of time. There was no longer any day or night. The light never went out. She never saw the men who came in, but each time a valet preceded them to blindfold her eyes, and removed it only after they had left. Dream or nightmare, the prison setting, the lavish party gowns, the men in masks. All this removed her from her own life, even to the point of being uncertain how long it would last. There at the chateau, she felt the way you do at night, lost in a dream you have had before and are beginning to dream all over again. Only been reality in a closed circle, a private universe, was suddenly about to contaminate all the customs and circumstances of her daily life. Worked in the fashion department of a photography agency. This meant that it was she who photographed in the studios where they had to pose for hours on end the most exotic and prettiest girls whom the fashion designers had chosen to model their creations. They were surprised that O had postponed her vacation until late in the fall and had thus been away at a time when the fashion world was busiest, when the new collections were about to be presented. But that was nothing. What surprised them most was how changed she was. photographs of Jacqueline. They were like nothing she had ever taken before. Never, perhaps, had she had such a model. Today she was wearing what the dress designers call a gala gown, the kind no one ever wears. Oh, in her mind's eye, it was completing, it was modifying the model. The waist was tighter, the breasts slightly raised, and it was the same dress as at the chateau, the same smooth, heavy, cascading silk that one takes by the handful and raises whenever one is told. No one wears these gala gowns any longer, but they do. And then she did something she had never done before. She followed Jacqueline into the large dressing room. She remained standing, leaning against the door jamb, her eyes glued to the mirror, dressing table before which Jacqueline had sat down. I'm sorry. The bright light of an April day turned the clandestine into something public. Henceforth, the reality of the night and the reality of the day would be one and the same. Henceforth, an O was thinking, at last. This is doubtless the source of that strange sentiment of security mingled with terror to which she felt she was surrendering herself. Henceforth, there were no more hiatuses, no more dead time, no remission.